There is no question that we live in a very strange universe. On the one hand, it doesn't seem so strange because it's all we know. Our day-to-day existence is normal and mundane to us. We get up, drive to work, eat lunch, and go home and put on some television or read a book. We practice very predictable Newtonian physics when we drive our cars, ride skateboards, or simply bounce a basketball, to a degree that it's innate to us in many tasks. We don't even think about the physics we are using because it's second nature. But as science has marched forward, the more we look into those physics, which at our day-to-day level are very basic, it gets increasingly complicated and increasingly weird. Some of it, such as the Big Bang, we can't even gather, at least right now, enough information to fully understand it. All we have is a piecemeal model with many missing bits of information. But in the end, it's still the same universe as a hamburger. And no matter how strange and counterintuitive the discoveries painted at different levels, it is what we live with, and always have. No matter how strange the territory astrophysics takes us. Stranger yet is the quantum world, where the physics of Newton and Einstein are not really dominant, but the uncertain and very strange physics of particles asserts. Here probabilities and uncertainties reign. But again, the strangeness of the world of the small still remains a part of the universe. It's all the same thing on different levels. But there are competing ways to look at the universe, especially cosmology. There are consensuses that form around compelling hypotheses, and many of those started out with no evidence, yet accumulate so much evidence that they simply must be, such as general relativity, which many scientists hated when Einstein first published it. But as the proofs and evidence mounted, it became a reality that, as of now, it must be how the universe works on large scales. But there are still open hypotheses that leave us at a loss to this day, such as the various ideas of what lies inside a black hole, or the open question of string theory, that does not offer many ways of testing it to see if it's true or false. Another instance of this is more obscure than those, however. Black hole science always makes the news, and string theory and its failures is popularized greatly in the pop science media and beyond. But this one hasn't gotten a lot of attention in the past, but its implications and outright strangeness rank among the greatest in cosmology, and that's saying a lot. After all, we're talking about a field where physicist John Wheeler once proposed that there is only one electron in the universe, constantly moving back and forth in time from the beginning of the universe to the end, to the point that we see it as untold iterations, as many different electrons, but it may be, just maybe, the one single time-traveling electron. And there are many other hypotheses just as strange as that hiding in physics. But here we confront a different idea. Intuitively, our universe is one of energy. You could say that all matter, for example, is just a form of condensed energy. You can release some of that by splitting the atom, and you can release even more by fusing atoms, and you can do a complete matter-to-energy conversion with matter-antimatter annihilation. Here you can also look at another of Einstein's famous works, E equals mc squared, perhaps the most famous physics equation ever. It is quite literally the equation that shows the equivalence of matter and energy. Energy equals mass times the speed of light squared. Counterintuitively, however, that may actually be somewhat illusory in a sense, though admittedly that's not the greatest way of putting it. A better way, perhaps, is to simply say, in the end, it's all equivalent to zero. This is one of those strange potential aspects of the universe that just goes against anything we know intuitively, and it's spooky. I know it's not the Halloween season, but it's me, and I can't help myself. You see, all that energy that needs to be present for the universe to do anything may actually come from absolutely nothing. As in a true nothing. Everything you know, you see, you experience, you touch, in this sense, was born of nothing. Known as the zero energy universe hypothesis, this idea has been advanced by a number of scientists, most famously by Stephen Hawking. The idea predates him though. During World War II, physicist Pasquale Jordan wondered if the positive energy of a star's mass equals the negative energy of its gravitational field, canceling each other as far as energy and ending up equaling zero when put together. George Gamow presented this idea to Einstein, and it so locked Einstein up, he stopped mid-stride crossing a busy street to process it. Gamow recounted that cars had to swerve to avoid hitting the two scientists. Hawking expressed it as a very simple, elegant analogy, and it goes something like this. Picture a nice flat lawn. You loathe the flatness with every fiber of your being, and you yearn for some topography, so you begin to dig a hole. You scoop out shovels full of dirt and begin mounding it up to make a hill. But that's not all you end up with. As the hill grows larger, the hole where you're getting the dirt from gets deeper. What you end up with is a hill and a hole. You then decide the topography is not all that it's cracked up to be, and it just made the lawn harder to mow. So you use the dirt in the hill to fill in the hole, and it turns out the two are equivalent. The hole fills in perfectly with the material from the hill, and the flat lawn is restored. In other words, they cancel each other out. The question here is, does the whole universe function this way? Does the total amount of energy, negative and positive, in the universe cancel out? In other words, all said and done, the total amount of energy in the universe is zero. The sticking point is that it requires certain things of the energy involved. You need a matter field of sorts that has positive energy, and a gravitational field intimately linked to it, part and parcel, with negative energy. What we do know here, in addition to the whole Hill analogy, is that symmetries and cancellations do exist in the universe. Positive and negative charges of particles, spin, the nature of electromagnetic waves, and even the recently measured strange flatness of the geometry of the universe all show it. So the idea does not come from a vacuum, pun intended. We do see cancellations in nature. In 1973, Edward Tryon published a paper that posited that the universe emerged from a quantum fluctuation of vacuum energy. This led to an exact balance of positive mass energy and gravitational negative potential energy. There were a lot of questions surrounding the concept until the year 1987, when physicist Alan Guth proved that gravitational energy is indeed negative. So in a nutshell, it may be that the universe produced a huge amount of positive energy, which we know as matter and energy, and at the same time produced an equal amount of negative energy, which is gravity, and that they are in yet another way two interlinked sides of the same coin in space that always adds up to zero. But there's an issue, in that there isn't enough gravity. The amount of gravity available from regular visible matter doesn't make up enough of a percentage, at most 37%, though probably much lower, of the total mass energy density to cancel out. It does not add up to zero. And herein lies something interesting. If you add in dark matter, which is suspected to exist because of observations of its gravitational effect, it seemingly enters the ballpark for the deficit, and the universe ends up equaling zero. This, of course, brings up the age-old philosophical conundrum of why there is something rather than nothing. The first problem is the observer. If you can observe nothing, then it's not actually nothing because there is an observer present. After all, nothing is nothing, and someone seeing it is a something. The question here is that did the universe, clearly a something, actually come from nothing? This means that the question may actually be meaningless, sort of asking the often used analogy, what is south of the South Pole? The question itself doesn't make sense, though in regards to the beginning of the universe, that may not be entirely true. It also digs into what caused the universe. If it came from nothing, does it even require a cause? Aristotle said yes, everything needs a cause in his view. But that's a problem because cause and effect as we see them are part of the universe. They are an attribute that wouldn't be guaranteed for something that happened outside the universe as we understand it, or before, or any number of other words that don't quite fit because when we contemplate it, we leave our experience of the universe. Everything that ever was, is, or will be, and it helped define our words. In a sense, though, it does come from nothing. And it's worth noting, as far as we know, there wasn't an observer present for the nothing. Some have tried to make the case that the universe simply is, and there is no cause for it. And it's impossible to know anything more. It exists because it does. I personally find those types of arguments unsatisfying, but the universe will do as the universe does. On the opposite side of things, it's been argued that since math can be used to express the universe in physics, that may mean that there is some underlying framework that forces existence on the universe. This may be backed up by quantum mechanics, where it's posited that virtual particles and bubbles of sorts in space-time spontaneously appear. They come into existence, and maybe the universe is one such bubble that somehow expanded further and became the universe, and that's how universes are born. meaning that naturally, every so often, are forced to exist. To put it another way, nothing is ultimately impossible, or as Nobel laureate and past Event Horizon guest Frank Wilczek has said, nothing is actually unstable. So who knows? But it is an interesting proposition that nothing became a something, and that may be why we are here. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently eyeing nothing suspiciously. If nothing can become a something, then is it really a nothing to begin with? Even when not being observed. Very sordid, the universe. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.